Hey there, Jim.
Hey, man. Glad you got the link there. You about ready?
Oh, yeah, totally. Got that link, man. Clicked on it. Pretty cool.
Yeah, so what about the doc? Did you got the show doc? Yeah.
Show notes. There it is. Got those up. Cool.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. So you didn't read it yet either. I thought I was giving you enough, you know. I you got your lights and everything set up too, or
yeah, even the camera. I think it's going. Okay. I got this Audacity thing. Wait a minute.
Did we not talk about this already? I thought I told you. Come on, man. I got my stuff set up already. We're over here.
Wait a minute.
12 o'clock. What is going on?
Are we shooting a show?
We're shooting a show today.
Oh, my God. There's a camera. There's lights. There's action. I have solved this mystery, Jim. Mm-hmm. We're doing a show on investigation and mysteries on WebDM.
I tried to tell you. This episode is brought to you by Tabletop Loot. We've been working with Tabletop Loot for years now. They were our first Twitch sponsor there when we founded the channel. If you've met us at a convention and gotten dice from us, Tabletop Loot made them. These are awesome people who make great stuff, and they're finally doing their first dice Kickstarter. Every design is inspired by Hubble photography. They're handmade and finished. They got sharp edges, clean look, and unlike most dice Kickstarters, there's no stretch goals or add-on only sets. They funded in 2 hours, and they've been at this for years. These dice are awesome. Check them out. Link in the comments and description.
All right, Jim. We've talked about mysteries before, but in the course of that investigation, we might have missed a couple of clues, so it's worth revisiting.
Certainly.
So why don't you lay out what we're talking about today?
Yeah, we have talked about it in the past, but my perspective has changed a bit since then. But you know, the core problems still exist, that investigation scenarios, as they exist in RPGs, seem to really frustrate DMs and players. There's a lot of them conclude that there's it's not worth their time doing these, or it's either too easy or too hard, you know, that kind of thing. DMs seem to think that withholding information or putting clues behind hurdles makes for a more interesting mystery, whereas players who often rely on die rolls to accomplish things and tasks in their games can become frustrated when a failed roll completely stalls out an investigation. And so there's a lot of great advice out there. Things like, you know, don't make them roll for clues, which is what Gumshoe game does, or the three clue rule from the Alexandrian blog. They're all great. You should take them to heart. But what we want to do is really put together a mystery that we can use that advice in. And so that's what we're going to do today. We're going to try to put it all together and really give the DM something that they can use.
Okay. So how do we start putting together this mystery for DMs out there?
Sure. How do we put it together? How do we put together this mystery? I think really before we get started, I want to, at the top of the show here, want to really give a shout out to some of the resources that I've used in sort of considering this. We mentioned Justin Alexander's Three Clue Rule. It's a great blog post. You should totally read it. We'll put the link in the description. But also the Gumshoe game from Robin Laws is an investigation game that is meant to actually address the core problem of a failed die roll stalls an investigation. And then I also found a game called Mean Streets from Precis Intermedia that is about role-playing, specifically film noir detective stories, and it has a lot of great information about how to set up and run an investigation. So I like to cite my sources, you know, and that's where drawn on a lot of that for this. But with that out of the way, how do we craft a scenario, an investigation scenario that really draws the players in and sets the dungeon master or game master up for success? And I think right off the bat, as a caution to DMs, really going to have to set aside any preconceived notions about how this thing should go, how it should play out. Mm-hmm. Make no assumptions about how the players are going to tackle it or approach this thing. You want to always, like, not make too many assumptions anyway, not have too many preconceived notions going into a scenario, but, like, especially with investigations. Because it's when the dungeon master's like, oh, this is how they should get this clue, or this is what they need to do it, and it's only this one way. That's how a lot of these things start, where a lot of these frustrations begin, both dungeon masters and players. And what we want is for a satisfying investigation scenario where the players have the opportunity, if they wish to take it, to actually be detectives. Not just to play them, mm-hmm. not just to roll dice and like have that be the be all and end all of their interaction, but to be able to actually put together clues and build a narrative that leads them to a conclusion that will help them resolve the mystery. And it's really that we want, because if you're just going to roll dice, there's not a lot of this that's going to make sense. What we want is for the dungeon master to like actually use the elements of a mystery to put together a scenario that the players can interact with and have an opportunity to like be Sherlock Holmes, you know, to not just pretend, but actually be him.
Yes. Let's not let them try to deduce what it is. What are those elements, Jim? Let's walk through them.
Yeah. Sure. So we're talking about the elements of a mystery here. And just by simple definition, the mystery is something where like something undesirable has happened. Someone somewhere has done something undesirable. Could be a crime, could be conspiracy or something like that. And the players are the ones who have to discover it and stop them or apprehend them or just prevent the undesirable action from either repeating or continuing. And so in order to set that up, really got to consider what was the time, the location, and the method for that initial mystery? What is it that kicks things off? And how did it come into being, right? Mm-hmm. For a dungeon master, you want to have the full picture of everything laid out. It's going to take work. I know it's a dirty word. It's going to require some prep, and maybe more prep than you're used to, because you want to have all of those answers nailed down or the vast majority of them nailed down before starting. It's difficult to improv a mystery. So you also want to know who was involved, who instigated this thing, who actually perpetrated the event that starts the mystery, right? Mm-hmm. Are there any victims or someone harmed by this event? Who are they? Anybody benefit from it? Could somebody be the sort of power behind the throne, as it were, that served as the catalyst for this mystery? And was there anybody just around, you know? Was anybody who might have seen something, you know, might have, you know, been like a part of what you might call collateral damage or something, where it's like they weren't the intended victim. They're still harmed by this thing. We might also consider what kind of mystery is this? Are we talking about like a crime has been committed and we need to figure out who did it? Is this more of a conspiracy situation, which RPGs, especially fantasy RPGs, seem to really truck in, you know, the cult, the cabal, mm-hmm. the secret society is doing something? Or is this like a phenomenon? Like something's happening. We don't know why. We don't know how it got here or what's going on. So we have to investigate this thing. Like a typical like X-Files sort of supernatural investigation would be like that.
Yeah, where the interaction of elements are creating something, not necessarily on purpose or with any kind of like, you know, malice. It's just the natural side effects of some kind of, you know, phenomenon. Or that episode of Doctor Who where there's the ghosts in the basement, but they're just aliens trapped in an interdimensional like pathway. You know, it's stuff like that. Yes. But fantasy is set up for those kinds of things. And it's, you know.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
Just a wizard caught in the middle of a spell.
Right. Right. I mean, fantasy RPGs give you so many options here as well. And they can spawn their own like side mysteries. They really mm-hmm. like create this whole tree or web of mysteries and problems to solve. But and sort of rounding out the last little bit of what you want to consider here, though, is the motive. Like, why did they do this in the first place? Like, you know, some of that, you know, if once you know the location, the method, who's involved, probably the motive's going to already make itself known to you as the as you're setting this thing up. But it's worth really giving this some thought, because if the motive is like shaky or requires too many like assumptions that the players are just never going to make because they don't live inside your head, they don't know all the ways that things connect to each other, then they might not pick up on the conclusions you would like for them to pick up on, even if they have the clues. So the motive, it's useful for here to be like real, like go bold, go easy, you know, don't, subtlety is not necessarily the thing that you want in terms of a motive. And oddly enough, subtlety may not be what you want in investigation either, because at the end of the day, you are asking them to piece together information that might not be complete and to arrive at the conclusion that is the answer.
Definitely. So you've got your clue dossier, you know, you've got all your info as a DM put in your little envelope. So how do you disseminate that? How do you keep control of all that?
Sure. Part of it is like information management on your part. So creating a sort of structure for yourself that you use to help guide the investigation and present scenes and information to, you know, to the players. One of the basic ways to do this is hub and spoke structure, sometimes called node-based design. In addition to the three clue rule, Justin Alexander's site has a ton of articles and advice on node-based design. But like the thing that you... that is helpful for me to recognize is that you've probably already made some node-based scenarios if you've ever built a dungeon, because that's sort of what you're going for here. Each room in a dungeon, if you look at it from a different way, is like a scene, is a moment, is a potential place to gather clues. And then each clue will lead to another scene, another location, another opportunity to get more clues. And the idea is that the more of them they gather, the greater their likelihood that they're going to arrive at the boss monster, the treasure room, wherever the end point of this dungeon is. That's a similar design structure here. And in the same way that a fun dungeon, an interesting dungeon, has lots of avenues of approach, lots of different ways you can enter into the dungeon, you can make your way through it. Similarly with a mystery, having more than one way through it, it's going to really benefit the investigation and how your players approach it. Because, like, I think one mistake that DMs make is you're reading, like, a mystery story, or you're watching it or whatever. It seems like there's this one trail, this one path of clues that led to this conclusion. And, like, okay, but that's a story. And what we're looking for is a setup that in the hindsight, once this is done, will create a memorable and engaging story. But as you're going through it, it's not linear, right? It's all kinds of things that you could have done, could have gone to, people you could have talked to, clues you missed, misinterpreted, whatever. Only in hindsight does it look linear. And so some of the ways that you can like make sure that at every point in that, you know, that conceptual dungeon, those hubs, that you're keeping track of the clues that are available and the ones that the players already have. So checklists are a really good way for this. Pretty much anything you want them to know, you're going to want to have some sort of list for yourself that either summarizes it briefly, just enough to sort of jog your memory. The checklist serves sort of two functions. It lets you know where they've been, what information they have. And it also lets you know, like, did you miss something in portraying this investigation? Did you mean for there to be this clue when they talked to this person of interest or visited this location of interest? And so you can look and go, oh man, I forgot that. Where else can I put that in? How else can I get them that information? And that's part of the essence of the three clue rule, which it's not that there's three clues per investigation. It's that for every conclusion you want the players to make, and they will need multiple conclusions to reach a resolution, you provide three clues at minimum for those conclusions. And so, you know, there's three different conclusions that's going to lead to a murder resolution. But it's actually nine clues we're talking about here at a minimum. And the assumption there is that they're going to miss one, they're going to misinterpret another, and they're going to eventually get one, and that they're going to need other clues with which to build their narrative. Checklists are a great way to organize that, especially if you note in the, you know, for your clue list, basically, where they can find them, who they can find them on, what conclusions they lead to, that kind of thing. Information organization. And then the other thing is timelines.
Yeah. Right. I use the combination of checklists and timelines.
Yeah,
so
right.
I have a checklist in my timelines. It's how I usually do my information dissemination now.
In
order to create a mystery. So
yeah,
I'm right there with you, man.
And now you're not hidebound to one way. You have a palette of options. You know how you're going to react to the players doing something. That's what timeline's for, right? Not just pre-investigation, but like post. Are you on the trail of a murderer? At what point do they strike back? At what point do they go after another victim? Right? Knowing those things and having them either written down of like, this is when it'll happen, or these are the conditions under when it'll happen. First off, creates a more reactive living world, creates a time limit or a constraint with which they have to conduct the investigation. But again, it also just helps you organize things. How am I going to run this? Mm-hmm. The more you can set yourself up ahead of time, the easier it's going to be to deal with the unexpected when your players do something you did not expect, but is nevertheless relevant and could lead to a conclusion that could resolve this. So part of this is like, what's the minimum you need? We talked a bit about the three clues per conclusion, and then at least, you know, three conclusions per solution. And again, these are the minimums. The more you can provide for them, shower them with information. This might seem counterintuitive. Yeah. You know, the mystery is defined by we don't know, but the purpose of a mystery is the uncovering of information, right?
You just have to give them pieces, disjointed and out of order. It doesn't matter if they have 10 of them. If none of them really connect to one another at the beginning of the mystery, they still have a mystery. And so, but you're going to create those aha moments later on when you give them that clue that connects two pieces that previously they had on separate sides of their little, you know, their little murder board with the strings and everything. And they realize, oh, wait, no, these things that we thought were completely separate, these go together. Boom. And that's when you have those, like, they have an upside, as Neil Stevenson would say.
Yes, that's when they become detectives. And not just play them, they are the detectives. And for me, that's the good stuff. That is why I am here. I don't want to just roll I don't want to just roll my investigation and get this over with. I want to like piece together the clues, build a narrative, reach a conclusion. And that's, you know, that's what we're setting up, right?
I mean, you know, like I said, you know, this is, you have to have the whatever it is, the who, what, when, why, where, how thing. Like once the DM has that, now you can start presenting all this information that you know you need. So what does that look like in the actual scene where your players are investigating it? Like how do you describe that?
So in an actual scene, they get to the murder side of the murder. They investigate the first instance of, you know, of a conspiracy or something. Your descriptions are very important here, maybe more so than any other type of scenario or encounter you might have, because it's the fact that the Dungeon Master ultimately is the character's eyes and ears and nose and sense of taste and feel and all that other kind of stuff, right?
Yeah.
Players do not get information without the Dungeon Master giving it to them. And so sort of corollary to that is that things that are obvious for the characters need to be made explicit for the players, right? Mm-hmm. Like, don't assume that they're going to make the same connections between things that their characters would, but that as players, they're not, because they didn't read the lore Bible, or they've more likely had like a lot of life to live between the last time you guys played and are not as invested yet
yeah.
in what's going on. And so making sure that you are generous with information, generous with your descriptions without being like TMI. There is a point at which you're just like, wait a minute, that was too much. So being concise, but comprehensive is what we're looking for here. Making sure that you're not flooding them with too much, but you are giving them more than enough. Kind of a balance.
Right. Well, yeah, it's a balance, but I think one place that DMs, GMs can kind of put a exclamation point on that is between sessions, like you said, we have life to live. So when you're doing your recap, you should do a recap when they come back to the next session. And B, if they found those clues, that's when you remind them of those clues in the recap, whether it's by putting it in there, you are making it explicit. You are reminding them of very specific pieces of information that you need, in order to continue this investigation. It's the previously sure. on. You wouldn't show them in the yes. previously on if it wasn't pertinent to what's about to happen, right?
Yeah, there's a reason why weekly serialized TV is the previously. Oh, yeah, to remind the viewers what happened, because they might be like, wait, what is this? And it's the same with your players, yeah. as you're saying, Yeah, definitely. You can also help with this sort of retention of information and getting them the information that they'll need by visual aids. And I'm thinking this. You wouldn't run a tactically detailed combat without a battle map and some way to note where your characters are on it, where the enemies are. You wouldn't run a location-based adventure, which is about like looking in the nooks and crannies of a place and really getting a feel for it without having a detailed map. Mm-hmm. So like two maps per scene. The Dungeon Master's map, which has the clues, the information, what you want to have on it and portray to the characters, and then a map for the players, which is as visually detailed as you can make it, right? Draw a little furniture on it. Maybe, like, if you want to go all out, you've got, like, the overhead layout thing, and then each room has, a picture that you've sketched up. You know, like, this is, from the point of view of your characters, this is what you see. You know, now a lot of this is constrained by time and how much work you want to put into it, which there is too much, right? You might be self-conscious about your artistic abilities of some kind, but you don't necessarily have to draw it. You can take pictures off the internet. This is what this room looks like. These are the things that are in it. You know, you can create sort of a collage or something like that. On your Dungeon Master's map, you can just make sure that you have like all the sensory information that they would acquire, so that when they look at their layout, the player's map, you can give it as detailed a description of that room as you can. You can take it to the next level, though, by having actual physical things to hand the players, handouts, mm-hmm. right? In the form of either cards that have, a picture or, something on them, some sort of symbol, perhaps, that denotes what sort of information it is. And then the summary of the information on the back, because just like that clue board, that murder board that you are talking about, they can start to construct their own once you start giving them handouts. They can mm-hmm. place the information in a way that they can then draw their own conclusions with. Bonus points if you give them a board to actually pin things to create a physical,
Yeah. Corkboard isn't that expensive.
Right.
That and yarn and push pins. That's all you need to provide.
Yeah.
Well, also,
out here.
Yeah, I mean, well, I was going to say, as far as going all out with handouts, I mean, if there's a torn piece of jewelry and you go down to a costume shop and get a string of pearls that are torn and you put like one dot of blood somewhere on it. So you're literally handing them a piece of broken jewelry that they can physically inspect and go, wait, what's this? It's like, oh, you actually found that clue. You're doing it without a role. You're letting them play their role of yep. being investigators and figuring this thing out by actually using their eyes. It just, like I said, it all depends on how much work and effort you want to put into it. But the more tactile things you give them to interact with, the more it's going to seem real in their mind, because you're giving them a centralized thing that they, that a shared space that they're all seeing the same thing in their heads. Because that, to me, is the most important part of the game, is getting like 4 to 6 other people seeing the same thing so they can all arrive at the same conclusions.
Yeah. Yeah. And more than anything, this investigation scenario, these mysteries, this is important, right? In a lot of ways, this is a bit of a tangent, but in a lot of ways, the exact details of what everybody's imagining usually aren't important. And sometimes it's kind of fun for a DM to ask their players, what do you think this place is like? Well, you know, like we've been adventuring in this location, mm-hmm. or you've been talking to this NPC for a while. What do you think it looks like or sounds like or whatever? Like, and that's a good way to help you know how you're portraying things, whether you need to up your description.
Yeah, it's the best, to me, it's the best tool a DM could have is after the session. Don't ask them how they liked it. Ask them what they, what did you see in this spot? What did you see
here?
How did
you imagine
it? That way you know how what you're relaying is being relayed back to you. And so you find out what's important to the players, so you know what type of information to give them.
Certainly, and that is to tie it back to investigations here, you can then alter clues they have not found in such a way that you are emphasizing the things they want to pick up on or that they will pick up on, right? And this is one of those things where kind of switching things around behind the scenes, it isn't like robbing them of choice or denying their agency. It's enhancing it because you're not in their heads, they're not in your head, right? But there is a limit to the amount of work that you can put in. There's a limit to the amount of space you might have. There's a limit to the engagement. But doing something to give the players a way to interact with this thing without playing Mother May I, right? And that's something I get frustrated by in an investigation. It's just like, well, can I look here? Roll. Well, I mean, I would have, like, if you'd let me talk, I'd tell you exactly what my character does, you know. I'll tell you
where chance rules everything.
Like, oh, maybe. But it doesn't have to.
Right.
So let's actually go through and talk about, like, the types of clues and sort of, like, both how they might be found and also, you know, what they might have. So this might seem obvious to everybody, but I think it's worth stating that the point of a clue is to provide information about who, what, when, where, and why, and how this thing happened.
You got it.
If it doesn't answer one of those questions, then it's not a clue that you want to give the players, because you don't know if they're going to run with that one and wildly speculate. And then you're going to have to go, wait a minute, guys, that was not, like, that was
not. Well, I will say maybe there is one cat... Maybe there's one caveat to that. Mm-hmm. If you have a bad guy who wants to throw in a red herring clue specifically to throw the players off, but there needs to be an obvious resolution to that clue that points to the fact that they have arrived at a red herring.
Certainly.
It does not need to be so obfuscated in the details that it's like an errant bit of information that can just consistently throw them off because they're still calculating it. It needs to be like, oh, wait, there's this footprint. So obviously it was a dragonkin. And then you get, and it's like, wait, no, there's literally none of that around here. Wait a minute. Somebody's trying to throw us off.
Yes.
Like,
you need to
be able to arrive at that if they do go with it.
Yeah.
But
yeah.
That then provides more clues back to the main trail.
Yep. Yeah, and it's a good technique for, like, later on in the investigation. Like, once they already have some information built up, if something seems incongruous, then that might make them go, like, wait a minute, we need to verify this, because this seems out of place. Which then also opens the door that you introduce something that seems out of place, but it's actually related, you know? So it's the big thing, apart from your excellent point about making it obvious when it's red herring, is, like, to use it sparingly. It is a spice that's nice. It'll really kick it up, but it's something you want to not overdo it with.
Yeah, that spice must not flow.
Yeah. So in terms of types of clues, there's obvious clues. These are hidden in plain sight, easily seen. At worst, you have to have some sort of passive perception or awareness or investigation. But I'm not sure I would even do that. These are the ones where it's like, that's a blood splatter on the wall. You know,
there's a broken window on right. the inside of the house. You know, I mean,
yeah. You just give exactly the information. There's no role. There's no nothing. It's anybody could have found it. Now, what's the significance of it? That's another story. Building off of that, there are hidden clues. These require you to search. They're very specific to the location. You know, we'll get into whether or not you should roll or just give them the information here in a minute, but something has to be done specifically to find this hidden clue. And then the question is why is it hidden? Did someone do this deliberately? Is this perhaps an accident? You know, that kind of thing. Next up are cryptic clues. Their location and meaning are hidden. Classic one is like a code or a cipher or something, right? Like maybe it's hidden in a secret compartment, but then it's also like, what is this? These can be big ones.
Or the way
these can be like showstoppers.
Yeah, or the way that someone is killed if it's a murder mystery. Like the exact methodology of how they're killed could itself be a cryptic clue. They're stabbed so many times in a certain area. And once you look at it, you realize that it's, you know, oh my God, if you put this on the map of the city, that's where each person, you know, like something like right, that.
Right. Something ritualistic or something, yeah.
Oh yeah, totally.
Yeah, this is the place to get weird, right? Like you can use like ritualistic or symbolic elements here in your clues. And like I butted in, was like the initial mystery might be, we don't know where this person is. And then it then is revealed, oh wait, they were killed. Or something, you know, and then the mystery deepens. Another type of clue is forensic. This is a clue that is revealed through specialized training and time, right? This is a classic like CSI shit, right? Like, you know, you're gonna take it back to the lab, do a thing. And in like fantasy games, to me, this is where like magic really comes in. You know, we're gonna do some alchemy on this thing. We're going to contact some extra dimensional or supernatural forces to figure something out. It's going to take us time. You know, there's something about this. Some speak with dead. We're definitely going to talk about speak with dead, but yeah, that could be one, right? Like we got to take this corpse back and like talk to it. And that's going to take a while, right? Because we don't just want to do it here. The killer might still be watching, you know? And so the big thing with forensic is it requires specialized knowledge and time, and that might not be something that the players have, so it's something that they can rope in an NPC, one of their contacts, something like that for. There's also serendipitous clues. Not only is it obvious, but it literally falls into their lap. You know, is one of those this is one of those things that you can help out your players if they're really floundering. That, you know, and they want to stay in the game, right? Like they're not like throwing in the towel and being like, this is stupid, let's play something else. But like they would like to continue, they're having trouble like, you know, just putting pieces together or finding enough pieces to begin with. Like you can just go, this piece of vital information kind of falls in your lap. And the trick there is like not bring them out of that moment too much. Like if you can align the serendipity with something that's happening in game, you know, then that's all the better. But in like detective stories and mysteries and the like, there's all kinds of like, oh yeah, we wouldn't have found it if the killer hadn't made this mistake in front of us or you know, something like that. We got lucky. That's where this comes in.
Or say that NPC that you roped in to do the forensic thing. They go off and do that, and while you're floundering, they come back like, by the way, there was this particular type of water, which is only found in the bog west of town. Lo and behold, you have a new clue. You have a new direction, a new lead in the case.
And finally, there's in testimonials, interviews with people of interest, persons of interest. These require some sort of independent verification. Like, you shouldn't just take creature at their word, but in a fantasy game you got a lot of options there. You can detect their thoughts, their zone of truth, there's divinations.
Oh yeah.
And so like it becomes a more legitimate source of gather, you know, information gathering and finding clues because you have those ways to verify it. You know, it's one thing when you're gonna like, you know, disguise yourself as a suspect's like most trusted friend and then read their mind while they talk to you at the same time, you know, like that could be a very interesting, scene to play through.
Kind of piggybacking on that, I'm imagining a good cop, bad cop scene where it's the cleric casting Zone of Truth going, we just need to talk. And do you really want this wizard to read your mind? Like, I don't want that. I just want us to have a conversation. And you can totally good cop, bad cop with a cleric and a wizard.
Yes. Yeah, I love that.
Because I love good cop, bad cop scenes.
Oh, certainly. Yeah, and that's a great setup for like a fantasy one. And that also leans into the magic that your fantasy investigators would want to use in those situations. Mm-hmm. And so, I have a lot of fun with these. I think that knowing the type of clue and the information you want that clue to convey is like just a great CYA for DMs. You want to make sure the information you're giving them is useful. They can use it to make decisions and piece together what's going on. And so knowing from behind the scenes, okay, this is what type it is. This is going to be forensic. It's going to require specialized information and time, and it's going to tell them the method, how of it, But then if they go to a cryptic clue, it's going to tell them like when or where or something like that. You can double up. Things can be, like you said, obvious or serendipitous once it's, found through forensic means. Maybe it tells you a bunch of information, but it kind of helps you just organize your information. Key here, in a scenario where the uncovering of information is the point, you want that information organized.
I mean, so what are different other than, I mean, there's obviously, rolling the die, but let's walk through that. Like, what are maybe some ways other than that?
Yeah. So I think like, I don't think it's time to throw out die rolling when we're talking about resolution in these moments. Mm-hmm. I think the first reaction and piece of advice a lot of people get is like, don't make them roll a dice to find the clues. And I would phrase it more like, don't make failure on that die roll stall the game. Because that's really what we're talking about here. They didn't find mm-hmm. the clue that they were hoping for and that you were hoping for. And now they have nowhere else to go. So doing this right is either setting like a super low DC for finding it, and then taking various either thresholds of higher DCs as what more information is revealed through this thing. That's a really good way of doing like testimonial, talking to a person, right? Give me some insight checks. You can either rely on your passive, in which case I'll give you some information. But if you want to like really dig in, then let's make a roll versus their passive deception, assuming they're lying to you, and see what else you can dig up. You might understand more about their motive or their relationship or something like that. Hints and hunches is a good way to do this. And so like mm-hmm. the point there isn't to like put a choke point or a bottleneck or something on the information, but it still lets the player feel that they're doing something. A lot of times just rolling the dice is a way to keep a player engaged and help them feel like they're using their character skills as well as their own skills. But if you're talking about a game like 5th edition, there's all different kinds of ways to not to not roll the die but still take advantage of the character skill. And if you check out our shows that we did this summer on skill checks and ability checks and all that stuff, that's where we talk about like automatic successes and the like. But they are there. There's at least three of them, mm-hmm. And the big one is just like, do they need to roll at all? Like, is there anything to be gained by them rolling? And the point of rolling the dice is that the outcome of failure will be interesting. It's going to add to the game, not detract from it. And so that's the first criteria for, am I making them roll because I just, this is a habit, or is it actually going to lead to something interesting?
We came up in like 2nd edition where we did a lot more question answer stuff. So like I am more predisposed to that. And so
I much prefer a back and forth between player and GM of if I search here, can I find something? If I do this, you know. But I think Cypher has taught me a lot of, like, there are degrees of success and failure. And so when you do get to that role, yeah, you find it, but the evidence is, like, tampered with now. And so you know it, but you can't use that and show other people. You know, you see the document that is mostly ash, and you read those last few words, but when you try to save it, it falls to dust. So, like, that's a thing where it's like, yeah, you found the evidence. Whether or not you can get anyone to believe you is the next thing, because you don't actually physically have it with you anymore. So I think that's things like that. Like, yeah, you succeed, but there's some problems with it. And so,
yeah, I think here in a minute, we're going to really dig into that, because failure mm-hmm. and understanding what failure means is very important here. And you're hitting on, mm-hmm. On the right way to handle it.
Oh, I was hitting on a segue. Yeah.
There you go. because thank you. I didn't pick up on those clues, Pruitt.
well, now it's time to talk about failure, Jim Davis, and it's okay.
Right. Talk about my failures as a co-host. We're assuming that you're not going with right place, right skills, right decision, automatic clue finding, that kind of thing, which is the gumshoe method. Mm-hmm. Totally legit. Love Gumshoe. I haven't played it that much, but it's a very fun game. It really makes you feel like an investigator. But let's say that you are, that you are open to failure. That the idea that the players could fail to find something sounds interesting to you, and it does to me as a player. Then you want to just be prepared for it, right? Like, what we don't want is for there to be failure and the dungeon master has no idea what's going to happen, right? Like that's applies to just about anything where you're rolling the dice, but in investigation especially, because they're so susceptible to a failed die roll just stalling everything out. You just think about it. Even if in that moment when the player's like, can I use this skill? Can I do this thing? Before you ask them to roll, just pause the game. Give me a minute. I need to think about this. Take your time. State up front. Not the exact consequences of the failure, but give them a hint or an idea of what the consequences would be. If you don't find this, you know, you might be missing out on something vital, but it's not going to completely shut things down. You know, it is still going to, you know, give you some information. But it'll give you information in a sense of like, okay, we shouldn't follow these leads, that sort of thing. What you're doing then as a dungeon master is letting the players know that it's worth taking this risk. That regardless of the outcome, they will get something they can use, even if it's not exactly what they want. So being comfortable with failure, understanding that it, sometimes it's okay, especially for players, and this might take a while, you know, if it's going to happen at all, for players to become more, you know, risk tolerant and accepting that failure is a legitimate outcome of their attempted actions. For a lot of players, that's not what they want. And so, you know, that's kind of one of those session zero before we start this scenario kind of things. But, letting them know in that moment that if they fail, it's going to be okay. Because even if we're rolling and the possibility of failure is on the table, we want to avoid a bottleneck. We want to avoid like, okay, well, what do we do now? Like, can we go play in a dungeon, please?
Yeah. When the DM goes,
Jeez. So making sure you're thinking in alternatives and avenues of approach. And because you've set this up ahead of time, you know what clues there are, what information they convey, you got your checklists, your timelines, your layout, all that other stuff. You can be certain when you're crafting the scenario that there is not just one way to approach it. And you can say with confidence to the players, this didn't work out for you. I'm not going to say anything else, but there are other ways to approach this. And this is a prompt for the players to like return to the drawing board, re-examine what they have, and see like maybe that guess or that, you know, hunch that we had isn't quite working. And this might be a place to throw in a serendipitous clue to give them a little bit extra, you know? Someone who was involved in the mystery feels guilt and approaches the investigators, that kind of thing. That's a way to provide alternatives.
What happens if all the alternatives don't work out? What if they just miss the clues? And how do you prepare for that eventuality? That's the better question.
Sure. Ultimately, this is something to do while you're prepping your scenario. What happens if the players fail to find any, like, not just fail to find them, geez, but that they don't draw the right conclusions or they're too late, something like that. Then just being comfortable with saying, yeah, they got away with it. Like, they did. The killer's still free. The Eldritch Horror was summoned. The crooked politician did, you know, is now in power, or something like that. And again, understanding that that doesn't have to end the game, that the game continues onward, and that might set up the next scenario where we move from investigation to something else. You might go from investigators to conspirators, you know, as you start setting up your own, undercover, undesirable operation. So just considering it, like not ruling it off the table, not going, oh, this won't happen, or how could they possibly fail, all that kind of stuff. But like, nope, they can. The dice will betray you. They are betrayers. They're traitors. They're bastards. Do not trust them.
They're sirens in the night calling
you.
They
really are. So just be ready.
Drown in a sea of ones.
Right. And if you don't want to deal with any of this, then the gumshoe method of, are they in the right place at the right time, asking the right questions, they will find it. Then the challenge is not did we find the clue, but did we put it together, piece it together with the others? Do we understand the significance of it? Like I said, gumshoe way is very enjoyable from an investigation playing through it scenario, but it is a different experience. You know.
Yeah, yeah. So you have all of this, all these clues and the weighted thing. How do you, from the beginning though, as a DM, how do you get the players to buy into this? Like, obviously you would have like a session zero and talk about it, but what are the ways that throughout the whole scenario you keep their buy-in? Bought in, I guess.
I get what you're saying. Yeah. Yeah. No, you're right. They're still in. They're all in it. Yeah. Before you start the scenario, if there's a doubt in your mind as a GM that they might not enjoy what you're putting out there, test the waters. Hey, you know, what do y'all think of investigation type things? I've got one cooked up that I think you might be interested in. And that's the key part. Not to phrase it in negative terms, like, oh, this could be a drag, but like, I got something special for you guys. How do you feel about this? How do you feel about piecing together clues to solve this mystery? Do you, you know, you don't need to go like too in depth with it, but what you're looking for here is to convey explicitly the kind of game that you want to run for them for the next few sessions. And this could be once, we're going to play this once, and the next week we're doing something different, or we, you know, this could draw out, like Call of Cthulhu is like the entire game is this, right? Like, oh, this is the whole thing.
Yeah, I mean, you're NPCs, you're investigators.
Yeah, right, exactly. You know, if you want to kick down the door and blast Eldritch Horrors, they have that game, but it's not necessarily Call of Cthulhu. Interestingly enough, Gumshoe has Trail of Cthulhu, which is, you know, sounds like a fun time. So just sort of talking about it with them. I'm thinking of doing this. This is how I'm thinking of structuring it. Does that sound enjoyable to you? Or do you have any concerns? Because I'm excited to do this. And I want this to be exciting for you. You know, let them know once expectations are set, let them know, like, this is what it's going to take to solve this. Not details of like, you got to find this and that and this, but just like, you're going to need to gather clues. You're going to have to get enough of them. to, you know, to draw the right conclusion. Here's how you get clues. You know, I think a lot of times players feel like they don't know what they're supposed to do in this type of situation. Like, who do we talk to? Where do we go? What do we do? And, you know, might be a challenge to ask them to, like, conduct an investigation. But at the same time, if you let them know ahead of time, this is what you were going to be doing, in the same way that you're about to run a dungeon crawl, be like, hey, guys, you're about to have to go sneak around these dark hallways and ancient chambers and deal with threats and horrors and get the goods and get out of there. Similarly, that's what you're doing here, you know?
Mm-hmm.
The big one of avoiding speculation. This will kill an investigation, right? This will cause the players to just burn themselves out and the DM to pull their hair out in frustration as they take a, you know, an errant clue and misinterpret it, or they've got lots of clues and they don't quite know how to put them together. And these situations happen when there are multiple conclusions that they could come to that suggest multiple resolutions. When it looks like two people could have done this, or that it's the conspirators or this other thing. And those moments as a DM, sometimes you can use them to like draw in the player's speculation to help build, you know, what you're going to do next. And in most cases, that's a useful tool for you as a game referee. But in this kind of thing, when you've got this is the person that did it, this is how they did it, you guys are wrong. What they're telling you at that moment, whether they know it or not, is that they don't have enough information. And I think that it's certainly perfectly acceptable as a dungeon master to go, sounds like you guys don't know enough yet. Is there another place you could go to find information? Or is there a lead you haven't followed up on? And if the answer to that is no, we looked over everything and it doesn't look like there is, then somewhere along the line, there was information you either didn't get to them, or they missed and you missed that they missed it. And getting them back to a point where they feel like they're in control, that they know where they're going and how they're going to get there. That's what, again, serendipitous clues are for. That it just happens to be there, right? You know?
Exactly. And sometimes because it is D&D that we're talking about here mostly.
Yeah.
And there is magic and gods and everything. You can create your own serendipity a little bit.
Certainly. Yes. And like when we're talking about magic, especially divination magic, but not exclusively in RPG investigations, there's a tendency, I think, to want to shut it down. To say, nope, no speak with dead, no scry, no whatever, you know. And I think that's not something I want to be a part of as a player. Don't rain on people's parade. Let them use the skills that their characters have, because that is why they picked them. That is why they chose those options. That is why they did this in the first place. And it's incumbent upon the dungeon master, the person that's crafting the scenario, to account for those things, to know what the characters are capable of. And especially in like default D&D, where the magic is a known thing. There are multiple spellcasters in any given city or town or little podunk village, you know, and these should be taken into account, you know?
Yeah. Well, this is immediately when I was thinking about, like, what is it like for a dungeon master to say, no, you can't use those spells. You are literally Jim Carrey in Liar Liar objecting in the courtroom. Why are you objecting? Because it's detrimental to my case. Like, are you going to tell the fighter, no, you can't use your sword because you'll kill my big bad? Like, it's the same thing.
It's right? The same
thing. You need to, but yeah, you need to account for those things. And here's the thing. If you're fully thinking out your villains or your perpetrators of this mystery, whatever it is, and they know about these factors, you need to think about, how do you factor that in? This is when you, if you're going to kill somebody, you make sure that you do it from stealth and they don't know about it, so they can't identify you. You don't just walk up to them and stab them in the stomach and walk away. You know?
Yeah. But That is the minimum you need to do to attack him from behind, disguise yourself, right? Like what if
that's your red herring, fact,
right? What if the fact that every assassin's guild requires their assassins to wear masks, like that's the point of it, right? Mm-hmm. And the fact that they're secret societies and no one really knows that is one thing, but like, you know, that the fact, you know, I created this assassin's guild as the dungeon master and world builder, they wear masks for a reason. But like, next level is like, what if they look like someone else? What if the red herring in this point is that the assassin was polymorphed or disguised or whatever in such a way that someone else is the suspect for the murder? And building on your point earlier, it's going to be obvious early on that they're not, but that little bit of delay was enough for them, you know, for the assassin to get away with it long enough, or to set up a further sort of layer of defense against themselves. You know, mm-hmm. the fact that speak with dead requires that the corpse be able to speak, right? I think this is one we mentioned in our last show. Where we're like, why don't they just take the head? You know, just mm-hmm. it's a headless body.
That's why the Vendo always took the heads,
right? Or take the jaw or the tongue or something. You know, the point of this is to say that I think a lot of times you just read the name of a spell or an ability and immediately, you know, your mind starts running with, oh God, it works this way all the time, and it's the worst possible thing I could think of. Where it's like, no, these spells have limits. And in fact, divination magic has some real limits that kind of make it not exactly live up to its name a lot of the times. And, mm-hmm. And in this sense, I mean divination, not just the school of divination, but magic which reveals information, you know, to be accurate. And, you know, if it's detect thoughts, then maybe they've got like a lead-lined hat or something like that. That's just the mundane way. They could have non-detection, an amulet of proof against, or, you know, mind reading or whatever. A lot of different ways to foil magic, including like a subtle counterspell or a, you know, someone else over there, you know, casting a dispel magic or something.
Oh, subtle counterspell. Yes.
Right.
Interviewing the guy trying to read his thoughts that did it. And he's just subtle counterspelling you.
Yeah. And that's a clue in and of itself. Mm-hmm. And this is the player's side of this thing, is they might get frustrated. Why isn't this working? DM, you're not letting us do this thing. And this is the moment as a DM, I go, or what if it's this? What if the fact you can't do this thing is a clue in and of itself? What about the fact that you can never scry on the people you think did it? What if that's a clue? What if it's not me being a dick? That's a side effect. What if it's a clue, you know? So these spells exist in the game world. They have limits. Account for them when you are doing your prep. And it really makes me wonder, the DMs who complain about this, like, did you really think this through? You know, speak with dead is the obvious one, but there's like detect thoughts, detect magic, detect poison, augury might be used, which I rule differently, but not everybody does. There's mm-hmm. contact other plane for the higher level stuff. By the time you can contact other planes, which is not that reliable, your murder mysteries and investigations have a completely different character to them. And as someone who designs those scenarios, that character should be reflected in the design of the scenario. I don't know, that sounds circular reasoning, but it's kind of obvious to me.
Yeah, what's your closing thoughts here as you take all this into account, Jim?
Yeah, I think that rather than have a reputation for frustration, being a waste of time, you know, sort of a trap for the players or you know, whatever, that we should look at investigations as an opportunity to deliver a different kind of experience for the players, and for the Dungeon Master to engage in a different kind of prep and a different way of thinking about their game that's going to have effects outside of investigation scenarios, right? Like, an investigation scenario fundamentally is about uncovering information such that you learn the truth, you know, but there's mm-hmm. a lot of situations that are in RPGs that have investigative characteristics, you know, or might involve tiny investigations in an overall situation, right? So an example might be in a dungeon crawl, there's a creature that's stalking the halls and attacking other residents. Maybe they got, somebody's PC last week and you can't get to the body to talk to them about it or anything. And you want to know what that creature is. Then thinking, like, what kind of clues does it leave behind? Are they obvious? Are they hidden? Is their meaning going to be obvious when they're found? Or are they going to have to decipher them in some way? You can go beyond other creatures and think about, like, situations themselves. To stick with the dungeon, what is this dungeon doing here? What purpose might it serve? What's in it? All of those things are mysteries. And to me, at the heart of it, every RPG scenario at some point is a mystery. If the players knew everything, why would they care enough to play? You know? And so considering investigations as the standalone thing is going to have benefits for everything you run, because you're going to start developing techniques and skills and tools for both players and DMs to better play other types of scenarios. And that's why I think it's really worth the work to, like, think this through and to present an opportunity where the players can be actual detectives. And then if they want, if they're just not having a good time, you can resort to the more, like, put fast forward on this. You find the clue, you automatically succeed on through this. You know, here's everything that you have. It's super obvious. But that's, like, to not start there, I think, is the big key. But to give them an opportunity to uncover things. And then if they're not enjoying it, the other methods of, you know, they find the clue if they look in the right place. It's going to be super obvious. Mm-hmm. Use those then.
Yeah. Besides, we call investigators private dicks for a reason. Just because you're having trouble with the mystery, it's not the DM being a dick. You need to be more of a private dick. Sorry, I thought about that like halfway through your description. I was like,
I see those wheels turning.